You know it, I know it, it's Star Wars. You either can't shut up about it, or you fucking hate it and wish your friends would shut up about it. I'm the guy who never shuts up about it. 40 years of movies, comics, toys, games, dildos, anything you can goddamn think of, it's got something Star Wars related to it. So if you're watching this video and don't know about Star Wars, what are you doing? Go and watch all of it. Except maybe these three movies, they're a little, Instead of talking about something that got utterly destroyed like in the last video, I'll be talking about my favorite film of all time, which is in the Star Wars saga. And it is Star Wars Episode 3, Revenge of the Fucking Sith. The fucking is actually not in the title of the film, believe it or not. The film is literally like the only thing stuck and cemented in my brain for all of eternity. I remember when I was 4 and watching this film as a kid. That's how cemented and iconic its existence is to me. Every goddamn day, I used to put the cassette tape into the VHS player and watched it along with the rest of the 5 other films. But fuck those ones. They're okay, I guess. Empire Strikes Back, more like Empire, doesn't strike back.
Got it!
I honestly can't imagine Star Wars without Episode 3. And it was the film that made me pursue media as a whole. Nowadays, Revenge of the Sith has turned from one of the most hated parts of Star Wars into as loved as the original trilogy. Imagine that. This film is as good as this film. It's even birthed an entire subreddit of just memes from the prequel trilogy, and Revenge of the Sith is number one in even that department. But why? Why is it that prevalent, and what do people find so good about it? And why do I consider it my most favorite film of all time after showing just how much of a pseudo-intellectual I really am for liking Ghost in the Shell? Let's find out. Right now. Even if you don't like Revenge of the Sith, or any of the prequels for that matter, you can't help but say The Clone Wars is phenomenal. And it's thanks to the prequels, and especially Revenge of the Sith, in creating intrigue in characters and relations that were meant to be further explored in works such as The Clone Wars. To think that a lighthearted film, maybe not that lighthearted, was able to birth some of the most interesting sci-fi concepts of all time. Furthermore, not forgetting about those concepts and instead perfecting them through shows, games, and books. The original trilogy was filmed with a sense of wonder, yes, but they were more micro-based rather than macro. We never really got to see the various other worlds, governments, people, etc., and how exactly they affected the grand scheme of the Empire and its rule over the galaxy. The originals succeeded superbly by allowing their characters to be fully explored, and be the driving force of each film's conflict. The first film that came out, A New Hope, focused on the journey of Luke Skywalker and how he began his adventure into the unknown. He met and fought various personalities, and along the way, made some unexpected friends. The second film, Empire Strikes Back, began to explore the mystery behind the most iconic villain in cinematic history, Darth Vader, and slightly began to show George Lucas's interest in exploring the mysterious energy called the Force, which he kind of ruined later on with midichlorians, but whatever. The third film, Return of the Jedi, is arguably the strongest micro of the three because it matured Luke Skywalker as a Jedi, as well as a person. Furthermore, it made one of the most unforgivable villains of all time into a tragic hero. Return of the Jedi in and of itself could be considered the film that made Lucas interested in exploring and giving backstory to the rest of the world of Star Wars, as well as further develop a villain that had stolen the spotlight for the most mysterious and traumatic character of all time. Almost 2 decades later, we got The Phantom Menace, and, to say the least, people were not really, really happy for pretty obvious reasons. It relied too much on CGI, and it also kind of made the Force into a bacteria? Kind of stupid, yes. However, later prequel films made this idea of midichlorians more of a throwaway line, and resorted back to exploring the Force in a more mythical way, especially in the Clone Wars TV show. We then got Attack of the Clones, and, look, Clone Troopers!
Oh yeah, I fucking love Star Wars!
And then after 2 films of subpar storytelling and critical failure, we got this beautiful, bodacious film. And even though I may not like episodes 1 and 3 as much as 3, 4, 5, or 6, I can't imagine Revenge of the Sith without them. As all these 3 films compose some of the most interesting characters, worlds, events of any story. The prequels allowed for us to learn about things such as the Separatist Group, the Trade Federation, the Jedi Council, the Rule of Two, the Chosen One Prophecy,
clone troopers.
Various battles, various Jedi, Palpatine's rise to power, the rise and fall of the Republic, more clone troopers. Natalie Portman, Anakin goddamn Skywalker, Ewan McGregor saying, another happy landing. Oh, and Jar Jar. Can't forget about Jar Jar. These films were meant for more than being taken at face value. They were meant to become rich over time through other forms of entertainment. I've been bringing up clone troopers for a reason, as even though they got barely any screen time throughout the trilogy, their name is plastered over the most iconic war in the entirety of the Star Wars franchise, the Clone Wars. The name was so catchy and direct that the company then created one of the best pieces of media I think Star Wars has to offer, Star Wars The Clone Wars. And that's something the recent trilogy of films, and even the most recent show, The Mandalorian, lacks. Yes, I still like The Mandalorian, don't lynch me please. They lack taking a risk and exploring everything this rich and beautiful piece of modern mythology has to offer, and instead they resort to nostalgia and existing characters with barely any need to even be put into the story, other than to say, hey guys, look, another standalone show is happening for this character in 5 years. Oh wait, never mind, they got cancelled on Twitter. And The Mandalorian is decent in exploring the Mandalorian backstory, but you would think that after two whole seasons consisting of 8 episodes each, you'd learn more about the world after Return of the Jedi. Season 2 especially has cameos and cameos and cameos. Yes, I always like to see Ahsoka Tano and Luke frickin' Skywalker. The problem is, other than maybe Bo-Katan, it felt like they were mere cameos, like in a Marvel movie. Characters in Star Wars aren't supposed to appear and suddenly disappear just like that. When they do disappear and appear out of nowhere, it feels forced and too sudden. It feels like they were merely trying to calm the fans that were mad about the recent trilogy of films. And honestly, I'd rather take characters that do something rather than don't do much in a story that has nothing to do with them. It would have been more interesting to see more of Grogu's backstory, more of the New Republic status, more of the Mandalorians as a whole. Over the past decade or so since Disney's acquisition of the franchise, we've had pretty much nothing. The majority of the time, what was being put out was rushed or insignificant in the entirety of the world, except Fallen Order. Fallen Order was pretty good. And thus, I'd like to now state one of the most important parts Revenge of the Sith and the previous films had that modern Star Wars just doesn't appear to have anymore. I absolutely loathe The Last Jedi, but one thing I don't hate about it is just how different it tried to be. Sure, it failed in creating any natural form of progression in anything that happened in the story of the previous film, or any of the previous 6 films for that matter. There's still no denying it tried to show a different side of Star Wars that most people don't often see, and that is the idea of letting go of the past and making your own fate. I absolutely loved that idea, but just didn't love the execution of it. Rian Johnson is a great director. He is a man passionate about making film in his own way, and I think he can possibly succeed in making his own upcoming trilogy. That is, if it's completely separated from the original source material, but also respects what happened prior. Rian, although I disagree with his vision and idea of Star Wars, made me realize the element the rest of current Star Wars feels to have lost. And that is that it lost its creator's integrity and personality to be personally reflected in the work. I think after the backlash George Lucas had gained from making the prequels, he had grown tired of directing and being at the helm of everything. However, he understood the entirety of his audience quite well. He didn't agree or appease them at all times, but he never hated them and instead respected them. Something modern Lucasfilm and Rian Johnson seem to have forgot. The prequels made Lucas see himself as if he was not enough anymore. Well, I'm here to say that, as a person, Lucas is allowed to mess up. He's allowed to try something different even if it didn't work out. Because when you try, when you do in fact show those seeds of interesting ideas in minuscule scenes like Anakin's contemplation or the wonderful Darth Plagueis monologue, you define your work perfectly, and that is that you define it as a story. You define it as something you can just simply look at and feel, and let yourself get lost in. When I see Anakin looking out across the beautiful landscape of Coruscant, I felt sadness and intimacy. Though the bond you made between Padme and Anakin may not have been done too much realistic success,
it was so beautiful.
I understood the feeling of love, fear, and anger in play at that very moment through the use of visuals. Hayden Christensen especially was just great, and improved this scene a lot, as he clearly shines as a facial expression actor, rather than, whatever this is.
He must stand trial.
I also understood the cynicism and darkness hidden away behind Chancellor Palpatine's words and intentions when describing the dark and grandiose backstory of Darth Plagueis the Wise. The monologue allowed viewers to run wild with speculation, imagination, dread, and deception. Every time I look at it, I go, no, don't do it, Anakin. Don't give in to the temptation. And the whole film has this growing tension as you get further in. If you're somebody like me and has especially watched it so many times, you know what is to come. And scenes that have that intimacy, that I love you like a brother, oh, I love you too, and then lead to the switch in the appreciation characters have for each other is just so mesmerizing. It catches you off guard as a new viewer, but it enhances your relationship with the story as a returning viewer. I'm a student who studies film theory at one of my universities, and one of my professors during his lecture said that Star Wars was never too keen on story, and instead was more focused on the spectacle. I respect and understand it, since he may think this way due to him having a more critical and complex mindset of cinema, but sometimes I don't want something like Ergo Proxy or Ghost in the Shell. Sometimes I just want a fun and livid fantasy space opera with understandable characters made by a man that loves the beauty and magic of film. I think his work and understanding of cinema is what inspired and allowed many people to appreciate the freedom of expression entertainment has to offer. It should never be limited to one political side or message.
This feels a lot like hell.
It should be allowed to criticize and appreciate everything, no matter how morally wrong it may be. Take the character of Darth Vader, for example. What he did was wrong. Absolutely nothing he did is justifiable. But it is understandable. When you lose everything like him, when you physically, mentally, and spiritually destroy yourself, you give up, you say, fuck it. I've got nothing left, might as well do what I want and then die. But when his son came back into his life, he changed. He saw that his father's life still had meaning, that he was always ready to take his older self back and become whole again.
You can't do this. I feel the conflict within you, let go of your hate.
That moment that line was said, it caused the man that hid himself away from this world to once again rise up and end his journey with a beautiful act of selflessness. What I'm trying to say is Lucas understood that there will always be some form of humanity and sentimentality found in the person or action that is usually considered to be wrong. George Lucas deeply truly understood that stories, cinema, Star Wars should be allowed to appreciate the wonders of life and let our genius yet flawed minds run wild. Revenge of the Sith is proof of that. It's at times downright objectively bad in writing, but it's got this passion. This love for talking about an interesting world that just gives me goosebumps and makes me have my mouth stay open at all times like I did the first time I watched it. I really adore this film and this franchise. I love the creativity and freedom of expression it has to offer. I love the fact that it spawned even more beautiful stories with passion behind them with people that shared the same appreciation for the saga as Lucas did. Even if they may not be as lively as previous works. In fact, Revenge of the Sith was the sole proprietor for me finding out about stories as a whole, and thus it made me pursue not just film, but anything I can imagine. I despise what has recently happened to Star Wars, not because it was purchased by Monopoly, but because it has stopped allowing creativity to run rampant across the most flexible franchise of all time. And obviously, it's likely going to be a different Star Wars film for all of you. Hell, it might even be one of the sequel trilogy films. The reason Revenge of the Sith was and will always be fantastic to me, even after the hundreds of times I've seen it, is I'm able to see it as how a guy that liked stories was able to create one of the most detailed, prevalent, and important stories in modern times, and conclude it with this grandiose, tragic conclusion. It's become modern mythology in and of itself, as it acts as a gateway to the rest of the world, our minds, our history, our very way of life.
The dark side of the Force is a pathway to many abilities some consider to be unnatural.
Can at first just seem like a cool line, but when you think about it, it can define humans' urges to strive for something they know is wrong. But damn it, we're just so stubborn we can't help but strive for it. Every line in this film matters. It holds weight to the character's actions and reflects those actions back towards our real selves. I will forever have a special place in my heart for anything Star Wars, even the sequel trilogy. It just won't ever have a VIP section like Episode 3 does. And so, thank you, George Lucas. Thank you, John Williams. Thank you, Lucasfilm. And thank you, Revenge of the Sith, for being Star Wars at its best.